Hello, I'm Lynn Bondurant, your host for our series, 25 Years of Progress. During this 13-part series, we see some of the highlights of NASA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, since its official founding on October 1, 1958. What is happening in other American science and medicine the year before NASA is born? Well, 1957 is the year the American Cancer Society reports a high correlation between cigarette smoking and lung cancer. And new element Nobelium 102 is disclosed by the Argonne National Laboratory in Lamont, Illinois. Overseas, on October 4, 1957, the Soviet Union launches Sputnik 1, the first artificial satellite. The Soviets' launch is for the International Geophysical Year, or IGY. The geophysical year is 18 months, from July 1957 to December 1958. More than 70 nations and as many as 30,000 scientists cooperate to investigate the world and its environment. Sputnik 1 concerns Americans because of far-reaching military and technical implications of the launch. Less than a month after the first Sputnik, the Russians launch a second Sputnik, which weighs about a half a ton and carries a dog as a passenger. The second Sputnik causes even more concern in America because of the large size of the satellite. During IGY, the United States plans to launch a Vanguard satellite, which weighs just a little over 3 pounds. The attempt to launch the Vanguard on December 6, 1957, ends in failure in a ball of flame and wreckage. T. Keith Glennon is the first administrator of NASA. He is asked why NASA was formed.
That's a fairly easy question to answer. Sputnik. On October 4th, 1957, as I recall, the Russians launched a fairly heavy object into orbit, and that caught us really by surprise. The Vanguard project had gotten underway in 1955, as I recall it, part of the IGY program, International Geophysical Year program, but it wasn't anywhere near ready. They had, I think, scheduled some launches late that year, that is in 1958, but it wasn't clear that they were going to be able to fly them. There was another competitor which had really never been recognized, and that was the Army with their Jupiter, which together with some upper stage solid rockets developed by the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California, finally was the vehicle which launched a satellite for the U.S. early in 1959.
And the satellite was called Explorer 1. Let's go back to after Sputnik's success and Vanguard's spectacular failure. when Major General John Medeiros and Dr. Wernher von Braun and their team at the Army Redstone Arsenal are given their long-sought chance, a go-ahead to launch an American satellite. They will use their flight-proven Jupiter C rocket launcher. We are at Cape Canaveral in late January 1958, as the covered satellite is placed atop the Jupiter C, poised on pad 26 for firing. Explorer 1 is to be about 30 pounds in orbit. Severe winds aloft force a two-day postponement. Then on January 31st, 1958, the United States answers the Soviet challenge in space. Explorer makes a major discovery, a radiation belt around the Earth. Dr. James Van Allen of the University of Iowa identifies the region. The discovery of the Van Allen Belt is an important finding of the International Geophysical Year. During a satellite television program broadcast in 1978, Dr. Ernst Stuhlinger, Director of Science for Dr. Wernher von Braun, makes this statement about the launch of Explorer 1.
It was a gate that opened into a new land. We hoped at that time that we will make progress and achieve many more things in space beyond launching a small satellite. I want to be honest though and say that at that time we did even not think it possible that 20 years later there may have been 12 men walking on the moon and coming back to Earth in good shape. Many of the dreams which we had at that time were fulfilled, but many other dreams, which many achievements were accomplished, which we even did not dare to dream at that time. However, when we look forward now toward the next 20 years, I have the feeling that the best is yet to come.
The United States space effort before the launch of Explorer 1 is fragmented. Navy, Army, Air Force, National Science Academy, and NACA. President Eisenhower appoints James Killian to be science advisor just after the first Sputnik launch. Keith Glennon recollects the writing of the Space Act, which forms NASA.
My recollection would be that Mr. Killian, who was the president's science advisor, had been appointed almost immediately following the launch of Sputnik. PSAC, the President's Science Advisory Committee, and I suspect Mr. Lyndon Johnson on the Hill did a sort of a cooperative job in putting together the Space Act. They had as a model the Atomic Energy Act. And indeed, if you compare the two, you find a good deal of similarity in many of the clauses in the two acts.
I see. Well, what were the major implications of the Space Act?
They simply said that we were to pursue the development of activities in space for the benefit of all mankind. We were to do it as a civilian agency. We were to be responsive to the military in the sense that if we found in our developments some gadgets, some information that would be of value to the military, we were bound to give it to them. And that was really the thrust of this act. We were also told that we should pursue international activities. And this is, I think, an extension of this for the benefit of all mankind.
The Space Act is signed into law by President Eisenhower on July 29, 1958, and on October 1, 1958, NASA comes into being. Glennon recalls Eisenhower's feelings about space.
He was not a space cadet. He used to say, as he looked over his shoulder, and he said, "You know, Keith, that moon's been there a long time. It's going to be there a great many eons yet." And we'll get there one day, but it isn't necessary we break our necks and break the budget to get there now.
Okay, what about congressional support at the time?
Congressional support was really very good. As a matter of fact, they were pushing us. I don't think in my 20 months there that I ever had a budget proposed to them that they didn't want to add something to. My stock answer was, I have studied this, we have presented you with a budget which is what we think we can usefully use. If we need any more, you may be certain I'll come right back to you. That seemed to satisfy them.